أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على سيدنا محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين. Sisters and brothers in Islam, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. Inshallah, we will continue in our series today with how to attain God consciousness. And we have said in the past that to attain God consciousness, there are certain characteristics described in the Sermon 193 of Nahj al-Balagha, the sayings of Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam, sallu ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Not very good, is it? Very, very tired, and seems like it's getting worse and worse every day. So we'll have a very, very loud salawat. Sallu ala Muhammad. And we have described this model that we've talked about to attain God consciousness, so that we can become al-muttaqeen, so we can get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have to have high IQs, and we talked about the Islamic IQ, knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in our first night. The second night we talked about having a high IEQ, emotional intelligence, and we talked about anger and how we can restrain our anger. Al-kadhumin al-ghayb wal-afina anin nas. Are you one of those people who will actually forgive? So I mentioned yesterday, for those who were here during the a'mal of Laylatul Qadr, which, by the way, I thought the attendance was quite disappointing, because you know, there is great emphasis on doing a'mal of Laylatul Qadr together, right? There is a good possibility you might go back home and you might sleep and things like that, but as we described, these are powerful, powerful nights. And of course, everyone has their own circumstances. People have their kids, they need to go back because of their kids, etc. But if you can, do stay, right? Because when we do it together, it has so much more power and much more thawab, right? However, I did mention that there's something I tried, and perhaps I was trying to share that with everyone, is that I messaged individually those people who I might have people might have misunderstood me in the past, and they might have been upset for something that I have said. So I individually went and asked them for forgiveness, right? And I asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also to forgive me. And their reply was immense, it was incredible. Right, and one of them actually put a tear in my eye because the way they expressed themselves, and it was really, really touching, right? And I really believe these nights are the nights of when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says wal'afina 'anil nas, right? Let's go and ask those individuals that are hurt from us, right, for forgiveness. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, as we said before, they used to throw stones at him, right? But he said Allahumma ighfir lahum fa innahum la ya'lamun. Yes? And someone approached one of our imams, and he started insulting this particular imam, right? And what will be our reaction if someone comes in and says, we'll be very upset and we'll go away and shout at them back. But what did the imam do? He said that if you are right about me, look at the humbleness in this, we talked about humility. If you are right about me, then may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive me. But if you are wrong about me, then may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive you. Such a beautiful language, something that we can all learn from. If someone gets upset from me, or I get upset from someone, I can say exactly this. If you are right about me, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive me. But if you are wrong about me, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive you. Right? Not may Allah put you to hell because of what you told me. No, it's all about forgiveness. Yes? And this brings people together. This brings this love and tranquility between people. And this is what al-muttaqina, these people who are close to Allah, the God-conscious people. Inshallah, today we move into this third category, which is the spiritual intelligence, and what I call the ISQ. And this is where we shake our body. And I don't mean our physical body, where I actually mean the soul, our spiritual body. Yes, we shake it in these nights. Yes, I cannot see my soul. And that is the secret behind those people who are God conscious and those who are not. Those God conscious people know and always are aware of the state of their soul. They know how is their soul weak or is their soul strong. And they know that through the strength of their heart, right? And so therefore, in these particular nights, it's very important for us to strengthen our spiritual intelligence. What is a spiritual intelligence? There is many papers, but one of them is Zohar and Marshall. They introduced the concept of spiritual intelligence called the SQ as a form of intelligence that is based on a person's deepest meaning, right? And needs to fulfill a higher existential purpose. They're looking for something. And I fear that those people who are not aware of God or not God conscious still yearn towards some spirituality. Now, as a scientist, when I go back to the scientific papers, I find that even scientists want to find something spiritual. They say, oh, I don't believe in God. You tell them, no, God. They say, no, don't tell me anything about God. I don't want to know anything about God. Do not mention these three letters. G-O-D, don't mention it. But I still want to become spiritual. Subhanallah. They just want to block God from their understanding and their comprehension. But they will still want to become spiritual. They want a meaning and a purpose in life. They still want that. Yes? I've had debates with some of them. They still want that, but they're just absolutely not willing to accept that there is a higher existential purpose in our life. And this is where the people who are in complete ghafla, those people who are completely blind in this life, as much as you try to, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tries to show them the way, they block it. So Allah says, well, you know, I've given you so many indications and so many different ways. Open your heart. I just want you to open your heart. Right? And you can illuminate your heart. You can open your heart by, of course, reading the Quran. There is a very interesting story which I narrated to one of the sisters. I just remembered now. Yesterday that there was a person who was non-Muslim. Yes? And he wanted to find Islam. He really wanted to discover Islam. So what he did was he went and started reading the Quran. So he was one day sitting down at home, reading the Holy Quran, trying to discover the Holy Quran. And then what happened was he stopped. Suddenly he stopped. You know, there were certain verses. He finished reading one particular verse and then he stopped completely. And then what did he do? He told Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he still didn't really believe in him. He said, God, can you show me any signs here? Anything. Just show me anything that will give me indication that you are real. Yeah, you actually exist. Maybe, you know, he looked outside in the window, maybe it starts to rain now. Or maybe my bed starts to shake. Or maybe the you know, I've got this pen on the table, starts to move, something like that, right? And he said he waited, nothing happened. He said, what's going on, God? Can you not do this? Are you not capable of doing this? Astaghfirullah. He said, are you not capable of doing this? Maybe you're busy somewhere else. He said, okay, maybe something's very simple. Like, you know, something special, I smell something, or something like that. I just want to know you exist. He said, it was absolute silence and nothing happened. He said, nothing happened at all. Even sometimes, randomly, things do happen. He said, even in that instance, nothing happened at all. He was very disappointed. He said, "Oh, where is God then? I need to see something. Show me some indication." He said, "Okay, let me continue reading the Holy Quran." He went back to the exact verse that he left off. What was that verse? That verse was telling him, "Do you not comprehend your existence and the existence of the universe?" And then he was blown away by that. He started looking outside. He started looking at the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He started looking at his own existence. As I am talking to you now, millions of reflexes and cells are moving around, and so that I can actually put these words out. Is that all created by random? Whereas Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was giving him, he's saying, "Why do you want me to show you any signs? Whereas the signs are out there, just go and look for them. Open your heart." That's what he says. "Open your heart, I will show you." Islamic spiritual intelligence, there are this person called Ilmi, who's brought Islam into spiritual intelligence. Oh, not that's not my one. Is the human inner strength that comes from the soul, the heart, the feelings, deep faith, guidance of Allah, and good morality. And this is what we're really looking for. This is, I put this so just to show you, this is from Ghazali. We showed a video 2 days ago, Ihya al-Umm al-Din, in his book, where he describes, these certain concepts. And they have, in this particular Fazl Karim in 1991, they've tried to put the spiritual concept of spiritual intelligence and how we can actually relate to our own spirituality. So he's put this degree of low to high. The high is complete knowledge of Allah and his attributes, and you have high states of consciousness. And remember, we need to go up. I don't know if the sisters can see this, right? Can you see this? No? Maybe I should go back. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali. I keep on going back. Someone moves it forward. I don't know who that is. I'll find out. Is that better? So he says that if we start from low state of consciousness, if you are someone who is in complete ghafla, someone who is unconscious completely, then you have this animal soul. You will have a soul, but you have this animal soul, where you are a man with a dead heart, completely dead heart, completely immersed in worldly things. As you go up in spiritual intelligence and human success, he says you have the nafs in ammara bisu, as you all know that, right? And then you have the outer, he calls it the outer heart, the qalb, right? Which is the an-nafs al-lawwama. And then higher, much higher than that, is what is the inner heart. You know, sometimes we get confused about when we talk about heart. And heart is actually nafs, right? When we talk about soul, heart, this is what actually we mean. We mean the spiritual heart, yeah? But this is our ultimate aim, an-nafs al-mutma'inna, right? This particular state where I am actually confident is the state of confidence in the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that particular person who was looking for signs of Allah when he did tadabbur in the Quran, when he actually looked deeper into the Quran, his heart was at rest. He was confident in the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the higher spiritual intelligence, the higher the state of consciousness, and where our heart, the state of an-nafs al-mutma'inna, is at rest. So going back to our sermon 193 of Nahj al-Balagha, and today's topic, inshallah. نزلت أنفسهم منهم في البلاء كالتي نزلت في الرخاء. He says the characteristics of a mu'min, yes, characteristic of a muttaqi, the God-conscious person. You and I need to be God-conscious, yes or no? We need to reach that particular state of high tranquility and state of nafsil mutma'inna. He says they remain in the time of trials as though they remain in comfort. What are we talking about today, my brothers and sisters, is calamities, bala. This is our topic today, bala, calamities. Now, this is an important topic, right? And I do not believe anyone sitting here, right? Perhaps, you know, the adults I'm talking about, hasn't gone through at least one calamity in their life. You can't. It's impossible. You have to have gone through at least one calamity in your life. What does Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam continue saying, Sallu ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad?
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
فَمِنْ عَلَامَةِ أَحَدِهِمْ أَنَّكَ تَرَى لَهُ. He's talking to this particular person called Haman, and he's saying, you can see in the person who is God conscious, you see the signs in him. What are these signs, O Amir al-Mu'mineen? He says, صَبْرًا فِي شِدَّةٍ. If you are a muttaqi, if you are God conscious, you are patient in calamities and hardship. Right, I'm just giving you certain indications and we'll move into. He continues saying in a different passage, he says, في الزلازل وقور وفي المكاره صبور وفي الرخاء شكور. He is dignified during calamities, patient in distresses, and thankful during ease. He mentions in his passage, he says in his sermon, he mentions these three pieces. He keeps on emphasizing on how patient we should be during calamities. Why, Amir al-Mu'mineen? Why are you emphasizing so much on this? It's because he knows that especially al-Mu'min, al-Muttaqi will face a lot of calamities. So, the question we want to answer today, together inshallah, is why do calamities happen? Why do they happen? Right. I've had a lot of feedback from my lectures, and I thank you everyone for giving me these feedback from the bottom of my heart. Overwhelmingly, alhamdulillah, they've been immensely positive, and I thank you very much for that, but I am also looking for negative feedbacks as well, so I can improve, right? And one of the most frequent feedbacks I get is the interaction with the audience and the role, the different styles and etc. And so therefore I've based on feedback, I've wanting to continue that. So I'm going to do a role play now, right? As embarrassing as that sounds. But inshallah, I'm trying to pass on a message here, right? And I call for my partner in crime, brother Hassan, to come forward. Sallu ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala.
Hassan and I are brothers. Let's remember. So Hassan and I are brothers. Yes, brothers in Islam and faith and biologically.
Ali, what's going on?
Yes, Hassan.
I remember you said I upset you in the WhatsApp group, but why are you taking out on the poor rug? What's the rug done to hurt you? You're hurting the rug.
Why? See, the thing is, Hassan, my brother, is that the rug needs cleaning. So I have to hit it hard so that I clean it.
Come on, you're hurting the rug. You're really hurting it now.
It's okay.
Poor rug.
Hassan, it's okay. The rug needs cleaning. You see, the thing is, my brother Hassan, it's exactly like a human being. Sometimes a human being takes beating, right? Complete beating, and they hurt, they suffer, right? But at the end of the day, these beatings make them good, make them clean, it cleans their heart. Like this rug, I'm beating it now, but yes, the rug might be suffering, yes? But at the end of the day, the rug will look beautiful and clean and spanky and nice. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. That wasn't my saying. Thank you very much, Hassan. It's the saying of Rumi. He says, when someone beats a rug, the blows are not against the rug, but against the dust in it. So my brothers and sisters, if you're going through a rough time, and maybe a lot of people are going through a rough time, although you might feel it's beating you, don't despair. Sometimes when we go through rough times, it is really beating us, isn't it? Sometimes we can't even, you know, causes all sorts of different illnesses, mental illnesses, depressions and stuff like that. But don't despair. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is probably cleansing you of the dust that is in your heart. And we all have dusts in our heart. Yes? And my message to our kids, our beautiful kids, who are our future, is that if you become sad, if you become despair, or if you've got a trouble in your life, don't despair. Okay? Because maybe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is trying to clean your heart. Maybe you've done a bad thing, He's trying to say, I'm just removing this bad thing. But at the end of the day, it's a bit like the rug, isn't it? It's a bit like the sajada that I was hitting. The sajada, Paul's sajada was a bit dirty, yeah? But I was hitting it so I could remove the dirt. How can I remove the dirt otherwise? I gotta hit it. So this is number one, an answer to our question. Why do we face calamities? It's so that we can strengthen our soul. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sometimes make us go through these particular calamities so that He can strengthen our. He wants to shake us, our brothers and sisters. He wants to shake us, yes? How else would it be? If He doesn't show us these calamities, we go through these calamities, we won't be shaken. Life will be so easy, right? It will be absolutely easy life. And then I am not noticing of my, I'm not in, at all conscious of my own soul. I can't be conscious of my soul. Remember, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to help us in every single, that's why we have Shahr Ramadan. Shahr Ramadan is here so that we can wake up. We can awaken our soul. Yes? We have calamities so we can awaken our soul. Every single thing has a purpose to it. And Allah is trying to help us. Yes, some people might look at it negatively. It's like fasting. You say, oh, this is so long. This is too much for me. Yes, you can look at it negatively. But you can also look at it positively, which is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is trying to awaken our soul. Number two, it is a trial. It's absolute test. How else would it be? You see, the thing is that this is a fantastic verse. Again, one of my favorites. Yes, chapter 3, Ali Imran, verse 142. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, okay, do you want to know who goes to Jannah? Yes, do you actually think Jannah is just for anyone? How does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala know if I am worthy of entering Jannah? How does He know? If I don't go through calamities. If I don't go through trials, if I don't go through tests. He says, أَمْ حَسِبْتُمْ أَن تَدْخُلُوا الْجَنَّةِ وَلَمَّا يَعْلَمِ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا مِنْكُمْ وَيَعْلَمَ الصَّابِرِينَ He says, I want to find out you. Two things. Do you actually struggle for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala so that I can take you to Jannah? And also patience. Two things I want to know. Then Jannah is open to you. It's open to you, but I want to know that first. How am I supposed to justify putting you in Jannah? Oh, I love you. I do love you so much. Allah says, I love you so much. But you just have to show me something. Today I was talking via FaceTime to my 11-year-old daughter. She was struggling through fasting. It's a message to all our kids. She was struggling. She's saying, Baba, this is so difficult. And I told her, look, how, you know, it's so rewarding when you have gone through some sort of hardship and then you are rewarded with something. It's beautiful. Allah doesn't want to hurt you. Allah wants to see if you are actually really worthy of Him giving you some sort of a reward. You know, kids, when we go to a particular, when we do something really good, like for example, someone wins a football competition, right? The World Cup is coming. When a team wins the World Cup, hopefully England, maybe not, right? If a team wins the World Cup, what do they get? I want one of the kids to answer me. Yes? Trophy, thank you very much. They get the World Cup. Why do they get the trophy? It's because they went through so much hardship, training, etc., and they competed, so then they won. They give them a gift. And this is what Allah is saying. He's saying, I want you to go through certain hardships in life, not so that I can punish you. It's not punishing you. It's not so that you can go through pain so that I want to see you go through pain. No. It's so that I want to see if you are worthy of a reward in Jannah, inshaAllah. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala.
And number three, my sisters and brothers, is getting closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's a very interesting hadith. And this is the reference, Al-Kafi, volume 2, page 254. Of our sixth Imam, Al-Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam, sallu ala
Muhammad.
إنما المؤمن بمنزلة كفة الميزان كلما زيد في إيمانه زيد في بلائه. Every time the believer is like the two pans of a balance, right? The more faith he enjoys, the more calamities you'll get. If you are getting a lot of calamities, that means you are getting closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the equation here. Yes? So don't despair. If you're getting too many calamities, that means Allah loves you even more. Because He wants to, He says, I want you to get closer to me. I'm going to put more calamities on you. I'm going to put more and more calamities on you. And you say, oh Allah, I can't take it. No, you can take it. I want you to show me that you can. Be patient. But some of us, unfortunately, disappoint Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not become patient. We start to question His existence. Say, why does Allah do this to me? Why has my marriage broken? Why do I have a bad relationship? Why does my wife do this? Why does my husband do this? Why is my job like this? Why? We keep on asking, why? Rather than, oh Allah, thank you for giving me this bala. And we go through these calamities one by one, being completely tranquil and patient. Now, this is also mostly for our youth out there. Let's go back to our prophets. Which prophet is this? Which prophet that destroys the idols, our kids? Yes! Ahsan, sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Very well done. MashaAllah, very well done. Nabi Ibrahim alayhi salam, as you all very know the story, went and destroyed all the idols and he left the big one there, right? And then when they came back and they said, who did this to our idols? They said, يُقَالُ لَهُ Ibrahim. He said, there's someone called Ibrahim. He must have done it. He said, well, interestingly, he's very, very interesting personality. If we really study Nabi Ibrahim alayhi salam, extremely interesting personality, lots of fruitful lessons we can get from his life, right? He said, well, if you really, you know, want to know who destroyed these, then go and ask this big guy, right? Ask him. See if he knows who actually destroyed. But then what happened to Ibrahim? One of the kids. Yes?
They made a huge fire and they put him inside the fire.
Ahsan, sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali.
They put a huge fire, as my friend said there, and they put him in that fire. Right? Now I ask you this question. Wasn't Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala capable of preventing all this? Was he or was he not? He was very much capable of doing that, wasn't he? But he still wanted to see the patience of, why of Nabi Ibrahim alayhi salam? Because he wanted Ibrahim to get even closer to him. He was very close, because then what does Ibrahim say also in the Quran? Rabbi arini kayfa tuhyi al-mauta. He told Allah, oh Allah, show me how you bring back the dead. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him, awalam tu'min, do you not believe? Qala bala walakin liyatma'inna qalbi. He said, yes, I do believe in you, but I just want my heart to be at rest. Now that's fine. A side point here is that even if sometimes you go through shaky moments where you do have doubts in the existence of Allah, it's fine. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, أُؤْمِنُ بِكْ بَلَى وَلَكِنْ لِأَطْمَئِنَّ قَلْبِي. Get me closer to you. Show me some sort of a method. Get me closer to the Qur'an. I can comprehend the Qur'an so I can get closer to you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Nabi Ibrahim alayhi salam was patient, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took out the fire. كُونِي بَرْدًا وَسَلَامًا عَلَىٰ إِبْرَاهِيمُ. Ya nar, كُونِي بَرْدًا وَسَلَامًا عَلَىٰ إِبْرَاهِيمُ. The story of Nabi Ayyub alayhi salam. Nabi Ayyub in chapter 21, verse 83. The verse says, وَأَيُّوبَ إِذْ نَادَى رَبَّهُ أَنِّي مَسَّنِيَ الضُّرُّ وَأَنْتَ أَرْحَمُ الرَّاحِمِينَ. He told Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when he cried to his Lord saying, harm has afflicted me, O Allah. How many of us actually cry to Allah and say, Rabbi massani al-dhur wa anta arhamur rahimin. When I go through a calamity, how many of us say, Rabbi massani al-dhur wa anta arhamur rahimin. So beautiful, isn't it? Rather than complaining every time. So Nabi Ayyub alayhi salam was a very wealthy person, right? As most of you know the story. He was very, very wealthy. He had lots of wealth, and he had a big family, etc. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did was he put a calamity on him. He wanted to do what? Wanted to test him. And he wanted him, Nabi Ayyub, to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even closer than Nabi Ayyub was. Nabi Ayyub was always worshipping Allah. He was always thankful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But even then, Allah put him into a calamity because he loves him. Remember the hadith of Imam Sadiq? The more he loves you, the more faith you have in him, the more calamities you will get. So, and Nabi Ayyub, suddenly he got this disease, a skin disease, that people didn't really want to see him. They said, oh, we don't want to look at you anymore. He lost a lot of his family, only his wife stayed with him. He lost all his crops, everything in this picture, as you can see. All his wealth went to zilch, zero. What did Nabi Ayyub alayhi salam? He said, Rabbi massani al-dhur. I have got a really bad disease. Massani, I've got some sort of a harm. وَأَنْتَ أَرْحَمُ الرَّاحِمِينَ. You are the merciful, the most merciful. What did Allah do? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala do? He said, فَاسْتَجَبْنَا لَهُ. Then I answered his call. فَكَشَفْنَا مَا بِهِ مِنْ ضُرٍ. Therefore we responded to him and took off what harm he had. And I'll tell you in a bit. And we gave him his family and the like of them a mercy from us, and a remainder to the worshippers. وَآتَيْنَاهُ أَهْلَهُ وَمِثْلَهُمْ مَعَهُمْ رَحْمَةً مِنْ عِنْدِنَا وَذِكْرَ لِلْعَابِدِينَ. And another, so what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did in this particular verse, he said in chapter 38, verse 42, he said, اُرْكُضْ بِرِجْلِكْ هَذَا مُغْتَسَلٌ بَارِدٌ وَشَرَابٌ. He told him, strike with your foot. After Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested Ayyub, he said, okay, you've passed the test, now I'm going to cure your illness. Remember, if you have an illness, my brothers and sisters, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he will cure it, especially in these nights. Ask him genuinely from your heart, in prostration, ask him, cry to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, beg Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, remove the shaytan, beg him, tell him, oh Allah, إِنِّي مَسَّنِيَ الظُّرْ وَأَنْتَ أَرْحَمُ الرَّحِيمُ. That's exactly what Ayyub did, right? And so he said, strike with your foot right here. And then he got a well of water. And he said, drink from this water. And when he drank from this water, he became better, right? And his disease was cured. And Allah gave him all his wealth back. Because why? Why did he give him his wealth back? Why? Yes.
He was patient,
mashallah, mashallah, very great son you have there. Mashallah. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala.
Stan, he should give a lecture. Here is water wherein to wash, cool, and refresh. And I've been to you. Some of you might be to Iraq in Hille, where I'm originally from. I boast about this. Go to Hille; it's a very interesting place. There is the burial of Nabi Ayyub alayhi salam is there, and also this well, right? I went there last year, where they say, I mean, I don't know how accurate these narrations are, but they say this is the well that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about in chapter 38, verse 42. Now, the issue of calamities. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala actually does say in the Quran, I put calamities on you. Yes? And we've answered why he does that, inshallah, with these three reasons. Now, we go back and see who does these calamities. Allah says, I do it. وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ I will put calamities on you. In what, ya Allah? مِنَ الْخَوْفِ وَالْجُوعِ وَنَقْصٍ مِنَ الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَنفُسِ وَالْثَمَرَاتِ He says that I will put calamity in you. It has to be any of these five categories. You can't have any other calamity. Fear, hunger, loss of property, lives and crops. Right? And then, interestingly, he says, وَبَشِّرَ الصَّابِرِينَ Give good news to who, ya Allah? Who? Who? I've got this calamity in me. He says, good news to those who are patient. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu ista'inu bis-sabri was-salah inna Allaha ma'as-sabirin. Just very interesting point is what is the difference between wabashshir as-sabirin and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says inna Allaha ma'as-sabirin. Oh, Allah is with the sabirin. And the difference with wabashshir as-sabirin, the good news for those who are patient. Now, when we have a calamity, I want you to reflect on which particular group you're in. Are you with the people who are ma'as-sabirin, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is of those ma'as-sabirin, or wa-bashir as-sabirin? Allah says, in this particular, when you have a calamity, most of us have patience with reluctance and difficulty. That's the thing about patience. Sometimes you have, it's difficult, isn't it? It's very, very difficult. Don't understand the meaning of patience. We don't really get what patience is, but I try to be patient. I don't really understand, get it, what it is. But I don't complain much. But patience is, of course, you know, having faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because I have faith in Allah, I have patience. And these people are وَبَشِّرْ الصَّابِرِينَ The good, I have good news to those. But, however, only a few of us have the other category. Allah is with those who are patient. They receive the bala with an open heart and tranquility. I've got a bala now, I've lost my job. Alhamdulillah, this is probably for the best. It could be Allah is cleansing my heart. It could be any of those reasons that we have said. Allah wants to test me, it's a trial, whatever. Importantly, this is Allah's bala, right? Alhamdulillah. Open your heart with tranquility. Don't lose composure. Don't get angry. Oh no, why? Complain, etc. All the reward is gone. Allah wants you to get closer to Him and know why we have these calamities. So basically, you understand patience. These are the people who Allah refers to, ma'as-sabirin. He is with those who are patient. Take a moment just to think about which category you're going to put yourself into. When you have a calamity, which category you'll put yourself into. Let's take around 15 seconds. Just contemplate on, are you one of those وَبَشِّرَ الصَّابِرِينَ? Do you understand patience? It's fine. Allah says, I give you good news. You are still patient. But there's a different category. Allah is with those who are patient. And this is, by the way, taken from a particular hadith. This is a particular explanation. Okay. Inshallah, again, with these reflective sessions, try to go back home and try to do continuously do these reflection sessions, inshallah. This is very important, my brothers and sisters. الَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَ After it says, وَبَشِّرَ الصَّابِرِينَ He says, الَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُمْ مُصِيبَةً They say what? What do they say? Tell me. What do they say? Those that have a musibah. إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ Now, the thing is that we usually associate this with people who are dead. When we hear about someone who dies, we say, إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ Okay, it's a calamity. But my God, there are so many other calamities. Why? When I actually get an illness, for example, or I lose my job or whatever, why don't I say, إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ Even if I've missed the bus, say, إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ Even the most simplest of things, to the most, the biggest things, such as losing a loved one, right? Allah says, الَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُمْ مُصِيبَةً If you go through a musibah, if you go through a calamity, whatever the calamity may be, say, إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ Say it, but with complete sincerity and appreciation to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Say it with an open heart. This is what patience means. Practically, you want to be patient? Say it. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. It's the best of formulas. We are from Allah and we will return to Him. That's it. There's no need for desires in this world. This world is not important. I am from Allah and I will go back to Him. I have a calamity. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. No problem. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Now, I have 1 minute left, 1 or 2 minutes inshallah, 2 minutes left inshallah. I'm going to take an example of a calamity because one of the feedback I got was talk about mental illness, okay? So the calamity of mental illness. Now, this is a quick practical step to whoever is going through depression, whoever is going through some sort of anxiety, etc. Try to practice these things through, it's a very big calamity, right? Try to practice these particular things very quickly. Access Allah at any time. Talk to Him. Talk to Allah. نَحْنُ أَقْرَبُ إِلَيْهِ مِنْ حَبْلِ الْوَرِيدِ I am closer to you than your jugular vein. Jugular vein, by the way, if you cut your jugular vein, you die. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if you cut this, you will die from me. Right? No connection with me at all. If you cut ties with me, that's it. نحن أقرب إليه من حبل الوريد. Talk to him. He's wherever you are. He is with you. He's your closest friends. Oh my small younger brothers and sisters. He is your closest friend. Sometimes you might feel lonely. That's fine. Allah is always with you. Always sitting beside you. Talk to him. If you suffer from anxiety and depression, talk to him. Anxiety is a result of worldly things, right? There is something worldly that is actually troubling you. And that's it. That's the calamity. But try to say, إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ Because the formula is that we will go back to Allah eventually. You'll definitely go back to Allah. And then you'll go and find the times that you spend so long dwelling about these particular issues. Pursue your dreams. Sometimes some of the people who are depressed, they hide things inside them. They have a skill. There is a whole world within you. Right? There's a whole world within you. There's a whole universe inside you. You're just going to unlock this universe. If you're good at speaking, not like me, but if you're good at speaking, then pursue that. If you're good at art, pursue that. Right? Whatever your hobby is, pursue it. Pursue your dreams. That will lift the anxiety and depression. Say it, my brothers and sisters. If you're suffering from mental illness, say it. إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ And also, إِنِّي مَسَّنِيَ الضُّرُّ وَأَنْتَ أَرْحَمُ الرَّاحِمِينَ أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ Today, we recite al-Fatiha on the soul of marhum Sayyid Mazhar al-Haq, Ja'fari. And we recite on the Fatiha on the soul of Sayyid Mazhar al-Haq Ja'fari, and also on the souls of all the marhumin, And I do emphasize very importantly to try to focus on these particular nights. Let's not waste time, yes, waste time on these very precious nights. You'll be gifted later on, you know, with so much blessings from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These nights, greater than 1,000 nights, inshallah, tomorrow we'll, at the end we'll be also talking about Laylatul Qadr. And if you can't make it tonight, then please do try to make it tonight. Tomorrow is the night of 23rd. Inshallah, Laylatul Qadr, please do try to make it. We'll all together do some a'mal, inshallah. Aqulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullah li wa lakum walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen wa salatu wa salamu ala Muhammad wa alihi at-tahirin.